Hey everyone, welcome to the Get Your Life Together Girl podcast, the ultimate blueprint to self-love and inner peace. I'm your host, Danielle Van. As a cognitive behavioral therapist, a life coach to women, meditation teacher, and author, I've spent my life studying and learning from the stories that make us human. It's my passion and goal to help you shift your mindset and create a lifelong revolution to help you reach your greatest potential. Let me ask you, if you had to rate your connection with yourself from 1 to 10, 10 being the greatest and 1 being the worst, what would you say? The only relationship you have with the entire span of your life is the relationship with yourself. But in order to level that relationship up to a place where it's thriving, it requires all of us to stop living in a space of energetic clutter. You know, the limiting beliefs, old traumas, perceived busyness, and so much more. Yet knowing you need to clear your life is incredibly different than actually doing the work. That's why I sat down with therapist and international life coach Tanya Cole-Lesnick to talk about the energy we allow in our lives, alignment, letting go of what doesn't work for you, and the small practices that make all the difference in our day-to-day experience. So let's dive right in. The Get Your Life Together Girl podcast starts right now. I'm very excited to talk about something that a lot of people have a new awareness of just from social media, kind of having this energetic body of ourselves and how we show up, how we live our lives. I have the expert with us. Tanya, can you please introduce yourself and kind of give us a background of what you do and perhaps even your why?
Yeah, sure. So my name is Tanya Cole-Lesnick, and I've been a psychotherapist and life coach for over 27 years now, so almost 3 decades. Mm-hmm. And I actually did not start my career out as that. Mm-hmm. I was originally a graphic designer, struggling to have a long-term love relationship, mm-hmm. wasn't sure what was going on for me, didn't initially consider therapy as an option. This was over 30 years ago. I felt a lot of stigma connected mm-hmm. to it, and also was dismissive of my problems being legitimate enough for that kind mm-hmm. of environment. But when it didn't shift in my life, I think my interest in figuring it out got stronger. And mm-hmm. so I did go into a therapy situation with a wonderful therapist who pretty early on added group therapy to the mix, and mm-hmm. she did both. So I was able to be a part of that work with her in both settings. Yeah. And it terrified me, but I agreed to it because I was building some trust in her. I was kind of intrigued. And being in that space was so life-changing for me, realizing that I wasn't alone. I went into that situation really questioning whether or not I was lovable because mm-hmm. I was struggling to have a long-term love relationship. Right. I thought maybe that was why I felt very flawed. So going into that experience and connecting to other humans on their mm-hmm. own personal growth journeys and being able to learn about what it means to be human and you know, that we all have insecurities and it doesn't mean we're flawed. And right. to have that kind of transformational experience. I did actually meet my husband fairly early on in that experience. And he and I just celebrated our 30th wedding anniversary.
Congratulations.
Thank you. So that part happened, but right. the part that I wasn't anticipating was connecting to myself in mm-hmm. such a strong way, getting out of some of the thinking that I used to hold on to about questioning myself, second guessing myself all the time, and feeling like maybe I wasn't as worthy as other people, that kind of thing, really right. healed a lot of that stuff. And then dedicated my life to becoming a therapist and then coach and went back to mm-hmm. school. And so I've been doing this work, as I said, for a very long time now, but really dedicated to helping people connect to themselves so that right. they can really experience some of what happened for me.
I love when we have a story that brings us into true purpose. And you and I were just chatting, you know, we both kind of started our lives in a very different way. Yeah. And then here we are. Let's talk about that piece, that not lovable what brought you into that room? Because so many women are in that spot right now where I think we get to a certain age and we realize we want more for ourselves, but how is a very hard thing to get to. So can you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, for sure. And I know we started with this idea of energy, and that's a big part of this. So when I was in that time of my life and wanted a partner and was struggling, I was in the space of thinking, oh, I must curate what I show the world, and was very strategic at all times, trying to show the parts of myself that I felt more proud of, or that I felt like people would want to see. Maybe they weren't even true parts of me, but I want to show up in a certain way. And what that did for me, that impacted me energetically, so that as I'm showing up, I'm not sure, I'm being strategic, I'm not fully present, and even I'm not very embodied. And so being in that space, it was harder for me to genuinely connect to people because I really wasn't even very present. And so I think the even when it started to shift for me, the question used to be, is he going to like me, and how can I present myself so I can make sure he likes me? And then what started to shift in that was like, I wonder who I would connect well with. I wonder who I'm a good fit with. I wonder who I like. And it genuinely at my core changed. It wasn't like, oh, let me just use these words differently. It was like, I was looking for something different. I realized that whoever I was going to be in a relationship with was going to have to like me. So it didn't make sense for me to keep feeling like I had to present something that wasn't a full version of myself. And I started to trust myself a little bit more. And then energetically, that made a difference, because not only was I meeting men at that time and having a different experience, and then met my husband, but I was connecting to people in general in a fuller way. I was noticing that more people were gravitating towards me. I was more comfortable in my own skin in those spaces.
Very interesting. So I heard two things, and correct me if I'm wrong. This is the problem with two people talking that are therapists. I'm like, okay, I hear perfectionism.
Yes.
I hear it. And people pleasing. As the method in which you were showing up in the world. But that question of what do I want? What do I like? It is groundbreaking for so many people.
Yeah.
We are taught, especially young girls, you know, you need to find somebody who is X, Y, and Z that will do this and that for you. But no one ever says, hey, have you thought about what kind of person you want to be with or around, or what kind of relationships you really want to have? Let's dive a little deeper into that, because I think that's a conversation that we aren't having.
Right. I think it's true that we don't pay enough attention to what's going on inside. When do we feel connected? When do we feel lit up? What's exciting for us? That kind of thing. And even to have practices around that, I know for myself, it's it's a daily practice multiple times throughout the day to just keep checking in. How are you doing in there? You know, what's working for you today? What's not? What do you need next? That kind of thing sounds so maybe minimal, but it really makes a huge difference.
It does. Yeah, it does. I personally do that as well. That's something that I, you know, I teach, but I also do for my own emotional body, my own energetic body. And for those that are listening that don't do that and they think, oh my gosh, that's so much work, set an alarm on your phone. It takes 2 seconds, right? Yeah. I mean, it's 30 seconds of your life that I promise will increase your feelings of happiness and joy, and be able to process much quicker than holding on to something.
Yeah, totally. There's a couple of apps out there that actually do Mind Jogger and Yap are two different ones, and they'll do alarms at inconsistent intervals. So you're not actually telling it when, you're just saying how many times and what times during the day. And there's something that's nice about that, not knowing when it's coming, because it will catch you when you're just not expecting it. And then a reminder like, where are you? Are you connecting to yourself? Yeah.
I love that. I didn't even know that. So there, that's a great tip to be able to do that. And you're right, to not have that sort of scheduled thought where your mind's like, okay, I'm fine. I don't need that right now, because we get used to it and we don't actually fully engage. So it's fantastic.
Yeah.
So as you made your journey and now with the work that you do, where do you find that most of us, and I'm going to use the word, I don't like it, get stuck?
Yeah, I think most of us get stuck, or at least most of my clients and probably the people that I've connected to in my life, because it seems to be such a common thing, is they live in such a way where they're constantly getting depleted and kind of focusing on the next thing and not allowing themselves, us, myself included, at times, this is something that I need to actively work on to keep this going in my life, so that we're not able to connect to ourselves in the way that you and I just talked about, because there's so much noise and there's so much, and I've been calling it lately, energetic clutter that gets in the way. Like, we're putting our energy in all kinds of places that are not helping us move the needle towards either growth or more peace or meaning or joy in our lives. And there's just this like rat race experience, whether it's actually like in the work world or not, it doesn't matter. I mean, even a day off can have that similar feel to it.
Yeah. Perceived busyness is what I call it. You know, we perceive ourselves to be so busy, but then when we look at maybe our actual schedule, or we're looking at what we're trying to show up to or grow, it's like, it's so minute, but because of that chatter, can we dive deeper into what you, you know, how we process that and maybe how we move through it too?
Yeah. Yeah. I think so much of that is connected to limiting beliefs that we all can hold on to. And I know you touched on the perfectionism and the people pleasing. For sure, people please, both are something that I've had to deal with. Yeah. Yeah. And then people pleasing, I think, is one that is, maybe they're both a bit of a slippery slope, but I feel like people pleasing, I need to really stay mindful of it as I'm going through, so I don't fall into that trap. So I know certain like red flags of, if I'm overly accommodating, that could be a place where I realize I'm offering something to other people that I'm not doing for myself or honoring for myself. And yet at the same time, I like to be accommodating if it works out. So to be able to honor and know the nuances, I mean, there's some nuance in there. So starting to identify what are some of the limiting beliefs for all of us that we bring into our adult lives. And so people pleasing is about rejection. If you don't do certain things for other people or show up a certain way, say yes, whatever it is, there's a fear that you're going to be rejected, unlovable, whatever it is. Worth is a big one that people really struggle with. Worth, control is a big one where people feel like, and a lot of this is grown out of childhood, not only, but most of this is, I know in my case, my mother experienced a lot of anxiety that came out as anger and rage. So as a kid, I learned, oh, don't rock the boat. And so that was where some of my people pleasing tendencies started.
Right.
But we all have the stuff. So the more we can learn about ourselves and learn what is currently in our adult lives still showing up, because I think sometimes people get dismissive of that stuff and say, that was so long ago. Get over it, without realizing how entrenched this stuff is.
And when we're talking about entrenched, and it's in everything that you do, it's the pattern, it's the energy that you are seeing life through. It's massive. And a lot of people say, well, I don't want to go that far. I don't want to go back to that spot. It wasn't necessary. I'm like, it's still in operation. You are still showing up in this way. You're telling me the problem is this. And I'm telling you the root is that, right?
For sure. Yeah. And I think for us to understand too, this stuff gets put in place because it's protective.
Yes.
We grow up in the lives that we grow up in, and we learn what's safe and what's not safe. And we start to develop different patterns because our brains are keeping us safe and we are dependent on our caretakers. And there are certain things that get developed, and it can feel scary to stop doing some of those things, even if we are safe and we're right. more in control of our lives. We're not in that same situation, mm-hmm. but it still can be scary to start operating differently.
100%. Let's go back to the energy and mm-hmm. let's talk about how you really get people to see what's going on. And then let's maybe even talk about some practices that we can kind of begin to nudge ourselves into.
Sure. Yeah. Yeah. I think even the term energetic clutter came up mm-hmm. for me recently. It was something right. I was actually working with a minimalist in my own life, because even though you wouldn't think my home is necessarily cluttered to look at it, there are just things I haven't looked at for a long time that, right. you know, I just wanted to clear. And it's, and then I started to recognize all the parallels between mm-hmm. the work that I do, the work that I was doing with this woman. Mm-hmm. And as I'm sort of guesting on podcasts and things like that, getting my language figured out about like, well, what is it that I actually do? And realizing right. that in all the years of the work that I've done, it's ultimately that helping people to mm-hmm. identify yeah. what's the energetic clutter that's mm-hmm. blocking them from the things they really want in their lives.
Yeah.
And so it's interesting, even as we were talking about the people pleasing thing, for mm-hmm. example, and how scary that can be to start yeah. to make a change. That takes energy, right? To do yeah. something that scares us, it takes energy, but that energy is going towards growth and will mm-hmm. help us move the needle towards clearing right. some space for what we really want and not be operating in automatic pilot, right? Right? So that's part of it. And to know that's not energetic clutter, that's actually energy well served. That's important. But then sometimes we can get into these patterns, and you might have been touching on this when you mm-hmm. were describing people sort of talking about what some of yeah. their problems have been, some of their frustrations, where mm-hmm. there's this circular way of looking at things and yeah. struggling to see that you can keep talking about that, but that's right. not going to bring you anywhere new. It's mm-hmm. going to be important to understand what's underneath that right. or how to let that go. I mean, when we can't let something go, it's usually because there's some healing mm-hmm. that needs to happen underneath. So right. to really help people start to peel away those layers and understand when are they moving towards growth and what's, and when are they in that kind of circular experience of going round and round
yeah.
and depleting themselves, but not feeling like they're getting anywhere.
Mm-hmm. Ultimately, the question is, what feels the best? Even if it's really hard work,
mm-hmm.
does it feel like you're making progress? Do you have momentum in your life? Do you feel like, okay, yes, I kind of feel shitty because this is the situation I'm dealing with, but I also know that once I move past this, mm-hmm. I can really feel better. You said something just a moment ago about looking at the circular pattern. And it reminded me of when I'm talking to somebody, I talk about, let's look at the global situation as a whole. Mm-hmm. Now, that global situation did not occur. It didn't close the circle on its own. So something had to have happened for you to make that circle, to make that globe.
Mm.
And we get to the root of the middle of it. And that's when they're like, but there is no middle. I'm like, it started somewhere. It
yeah.
didn't become a whole problem immediately.
Yeah. And to start to understand mm-hmm. all the different layers, and that it's so human. I mean, I think that that's the yeah. part, and that's where group for me feels so powerful, because it is a tool that I use. I love group. It changed my life, but it's mm-hmm. also something that I use in my work. And it's sort of my favorite thing, because I think there's something about being in that space with other people in that space where we can see ourselves mm-hmm. in a way we can't otherwise. Like right. it, yeah.
I mm-hmm. agree with you 100%. I do have a women's circle group that I spend time with. And it's always interesting too, when you're sitting there and you're kind of guiding and people are talking and they get that moment where, like you had said, I'm not alone. And they hear somebody and it resonates everything mm-hmm. that they have been working on. And they're like, oh my gosh.
Yeah, that's my favorite thing. Yeah. And I very deliberately in every single group session, I always say what's resonating, you know, mm-hmm. and because it is that, I think, and yeah. then to name it and put it out there, I think is so helpful in like letting that be part of the growth and looking at it, and probably helpful in what you're talking about with people about like, where's that middle stuff? You know, what are all the little bits and pieces that are part of this story?
Yeah. Sometimes we can't explain what's going on in our thought process in our head, and we even try to make sense of things that are, you know, old and in the past, and maybe we don't remember all the nuances and the details. Mm-hmm. And then we hear someone say something and we're like, that's it.
Yeah.
That's the problem. That's the situation, or that's what I want to address. It's so satisfying.
Yeah. Yeah. I love it.
So as we are talking about, okay, we have the limiting beliefs. We know that those own us 100%. And there are so many ways to get through that. Therapy is going to be your best one, right? Mm-hmm. And then we find ourselves, okay, we cleared, but now I have this sort of empty space that I need to fill with new beautiful energy and new beautiful practices and conversations internally. I want to touch a little bit on that.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think it's not a first you do this thing, then you do this next thing. I think, and what makes it tricky, but maybe also accessible in a way, is that it kind of all happens at the same time.
Yes. Yeah.
And so there's clearing that's happening at the same time as checking in. It's really a process of learning how to connect to yourself so you can be in process with yourself. So checking in about things, what does resonate, knowing that there's something that's starting to show up in your thoughts or that you're having a memory of being excited about something and wanting to come back to something, but feeling like not yet, not yet. But then very deliberately realizing where do you want to put your energy and making some choices about that all in the same process. So for me, an example is because I used to be a graphic designer and then I switched careers. So I kind of left that part of myself behind. I became a therapist and coach, but lately, as I've been clearing sort of this next phase, because there's always stuff to clear and we're always growing and evolving, I am realizing how much I'm longing to reconnect to some of that creative part of myself and starting to little by little, this stuff is little by little incremental, but starting to create a little bit of space where I'm connected to that part of myself. And I think to let it be gray, I think people want that clarity so badly, but really that clarity comes, Marie Forleo says, like clarity comes from engagement. And I always find that so helpful just to remember that we can't just think our way into it. It's got to be thought and action together give us a felt sense in our bodies. We start to know what sparks for us. We know what feels right or what doesn't, or what's not what we imagined. And then we say, you know what? I thought it was going to be this one way and it's not. So I'm going to let that one go.
Right. Yeah. So important. Everything you just said, because when we are doing that work and we're doing it all at once, we do start picking up pieces of ourselves that maybe we did push aside in order to do something else. Mm-hmm. And there's this love to it. I mean, I'm going to be honest, besides helping women, that's why I started this podcast. It was like, I missed that piece of myself, right? Like I love the creative nature of telling somebody's story or helping somebody. And so, what fires you up? What actually feeds your soul? Like I said a few minutes ago, how do I feel? Mm-hmm. Does this feel good?
Yeah.
And that is all about energy.
Yeah, for sure. And that we really can't access that stuff if we're so caught up in the other things and getting ourselves depleted and then kind of vegging out because we're exhausted from all the other stuff we've been doing, then we're so disconnected from even knowing what the little sparks might be.
Right. How can we start to get there? What's your perspective other than, you know, sitting in session or in the group? Like, how can we begin to narrow our focus down and say, okay, what is all of this? What's happening?
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, one thing that I have on my website for free is just this little 7-minute masterclass, but it's really a 3-question inquiry, and I can tell you what the questions are, but it's really about what do you want more of? What do you want less of? And how are you going to honor that? But the way that I suggest doing that is in real time. Just look at day by day. There's going to be repetition in there. And sometimes when there's repetition, it can be helpful because you're like, all right, I hear you. Like, I don't want to keep coming back to this. I want this and I'm not doing it. So it might be just a bit of a push. And yeah, just starting to figure out how am I going to honor it, being engaged in a process. Mm-hmm. Julia Cameron, who wrote The Artist's Way, which has been very helpful for many people with the creative process. She talks about taking yourself on artist's dates as part of your creative process. But I think it's good just to connect to yourself as a human. And, and all that is putting yourself like very deliberately going into spaces that can be inspiring for you. So it could be a bookstore, it could be nature, it could be going to a show, whatever it is, but to be in a place where you're opening yourself up to learning what's coming up for you and staying open to that.
Yeah. It reminds me of a place that a lot of people think is rock bottom, but it's not. But they will say, I really don't know what I want, or I didn't really realize that this was all my life was going to be. Those two places, I think, are so fundamental, because that is you talking to yourself saying, there has to be more.
Yeah. Yeah. And I love that you're framing that as not rock bottom. Like that's the good news. The good news is you're recognizing that and then have some inspiration to start this like self-inquiry and start to figure it out then and see what else, what is more then? What does that look like?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. Rock bottom would be staying there.
Right. Yeah.
You stay there, ladies. That's where rock bottom begins to eventually wear on you. We have the burnout and life just feels really terrible and we don't make any progress.
That's rock bottom.
Asking those questions is sort of the fork in the road that says, ah, I get to do something different. This is amazing. May scare the hell out of me, but what do I want?
I love those three questions. Thanks.
And
I think also what you're saying about that discomfort, I mean, transformation is so connected to discomfort. And, you know, I think sometimes we can really want to avoid that discomfort, but if we can sit with it and let it help us grow to whatever's next for us, it's going to be so helpful in learning about what we want and need. And if we're not afraid of it and can sort of use it as a tool, that can be part of the journey.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm sure you hear this all the time because I know I do. I didn't know this was going to be so hard.
Yeah.
I'm like,
Okay.
What else have you done? You know, where's your internal battery for the resilience that you've already built to get you through this next phase so that we can begin to fill us with something new, something interesting, something that is, you know, making you want to get out of bed in the morning.
Yeah.
Can you talk a little bit about that? I think that a lot of, well, most women try to quit pretty early on, right?
This
is too much work.
Yeah. Well, it's interesting because I'm thinking as you're saying that, like I didn't realize it was going to be so hard, and it is hard. And I know even when I make these little videos that I make, I often end it by saying, remember to be kind to yourself, because we can beat up on ourselves because we're struggling. And also there are such little incremental movement that we can make that goes such a long way. So I think both can be true.
Right.
And even what we were saying about having some sort of simple practice of checking in with yourself, it can both feel like a lot of work. And also it's 30 seconds or however many seconds that you give that, you know, in your process in the day. So I think to really trust in, there can be twists and turns that do feel good, even within, you know, minutes of these moments where it feels daunting and overwhelming.
Right. Yeah. Let's talk about some of those more finite movements. Mm-hmm. How would you guide someone as they begin? And of course, ladies, this is a very generalized conversation at this point when we're talking about having an experience or showing up to some change. But how would you guide someone to start looking at some of those smaller shifts?
Yeah, I think what I first suggest often for people is to start to track the things that they're feeling not good about. So things mm-hmm. like, I mean, I know I've talked about feeling depleted, certainly feeling irritable a lot of times, right. maybe feeling resentful, starting to track when are these things happening? That's mm-hmm. a helpful place to start.
Right.
And then when you start to track it, you can start to identify some patterns like, right. oh, I feel resentful all the time because I'm saying yes to whoever it is that you're right. saying yes to, and realizing, and then that's helpful because that can give us the specifics.
Right.
The more specific we can get, the more we're like addressing something that we personally need to be addressing. So mm-hmm. we'll go with the resentful idea. So somebody's realizing they're feeling resentful and then realizing, oh, they say yes to whatever it is. They don't want to be saying yes. And so then the next goal might be to start to identify what might you say no to, not even mm-hmm. saying no yet, because right. it's these tiny little steps that are going to help us move in that direction. And if the step is too big, sometimes we can get so overwhelmed or right. feel like it's such a struggle and then feel frustrated that we're not able to mm-hmm. do it, that there can be some sort of like, and I think you described this earlier about like, all right, that's it. I'm not going to yeah. do it. It's too much. If you can trust that this is like every tiny little bit of movement mm-hmm. is huge and we can celebrate that.
Yeah.
And I think then starting to identify, okay, I need to say no. What does that look like? Okay. And then maybe picking a time, I think I'm going to say no to this particular thing. Mm-hmm. And then whatever, each of us will help to support it. So for some people, it might be something like, all right, I'm going to say no. I don't usually say no to this.
Yeah.
Calling a friend right before you do it, letting mm-hmm. your friend know you're about to do this big thing, then doing it, and then calling your friend and say, okay, just did it. So you can have a bit of a celebration. I think
yes.
celebration is such an important part of this process because it isn't easy. And so yeah. if we can celebrate each other, especially with people who get it mm-hmm. and yeah.
So I think if you don't take that time to celebrate too, everything feels heavy. Mm-hmm. And because even if we say no, we may not actually feel good about saying no until it becomes the practice.
That is a good point. Right. It's not like, oh, I've said no, I feel amazing. Although right. you could, I suppose
you could.
You could be yeah. like, yay, I did it. But you're right. Like, and it goes back to some of that fear stuff we were talking about. Mm-hmm. Like, there's a reason why you're saying yes to things you don't want to be saying yes to. So yes. if you're saying no, it's going to bring up some of that fear. The reason why you weren't saying no to begin with is going right. to be alive and well and sort of mm-hmm. bubbling up. And right. so for sure, that stuff is tricky. And again, that's what I love about group, because group is like, you've got your kind of your own little team
yes.
and we really know what's going on in people's inner worlds. And mm-hmm. we can say, wow, that was amazing. Right. You did that. And mm-hmm. even if you're in some sort of a group situation, even if you're not actually having that conversation in the moment,
right.
I think there's a sense of connection still that exists Absolutely. As you're taking some of those steps.
Well, when you have that support in your mind, you kind of stamp that place of, hey, next time we're together, we're going to talk about that.
That's right.
Celebrate it. Right. And so yeah. that gives you that high of there's a celebration.
Yeah.
The other point I want to bring up too, ladies, is if you don't have somebody like this in your life, get somebody who can be your celebration partner, your accountability mm-hmm. partner. Right. And just, you know, be in that space with each other where maybe once a day or maybe every other day that you send the text or a phone call that says, how can I support you today? How can I celebrate you today? Right.
I love that. Yeah.
How can I show up for you today? Those three things make you feel seen, make you feel heard, and you realize, you know, I'm not in this alone. And what a beautiful
right.
energy, you know, take the clutter away. That's building.
Yeah. Yeah. I love that. And I think to not pathologize it, I think we can, right. There's such shame sometimes that people experience with their struggles. Yeah. And when they start to trust somebody enough, so maybe a friend, an accountability partner, or somebody enough to start sharing some of this thing, I think you're going to learn you're so not alone. If you allow yourself to be vulnerable with somebody else, it does give permission to us all. You know, when we can hear somebody else be vulnerable, I think it's so healing for all of us. And then it gives us permission to do the same.
Yeah. It's beautiful. And permission to do the same. Let's talk about that for just a moment, because when we do have that space that we can connect with somebody, it is permission. However, if you don't have that person, the permission falls on you.
Yeah. Yeah. And what does that look like? And actually, yes, the permission, you know, Brené Brown does these like permission slips. That's kind of what she does. And I think she literally like writes out permission,
sticks
them in her pockets. And so I just love that because yes, it is really that we need to give ourselves permission. And it is great if we can feel permission from sort of other people, connection. And so it helps us to feel safer.
Right.
Something, but yeah, we're not always going to be able to have that experience necessarily. And how can we support ourselves then?
Absolutely. I do love the permission slips. As we begin to change and make those finite movements, a lot of people will say, okay, but what should I be expecting? How should I feel after I start doing this? What's your thoughts?
Well, what came to my mind actually is what if we used how we feel as the barometer? I mean, that's part of the checking in that we're talking about. Right. And it's not like, oh, I've gotten here and then I'm done. It's really about finding processes that help us to live in a way that we're connecting to ourselves. We're connecting to what we have meaning to our I have always think about being in alignment inside and out and how important that is. And in terms of sort of the energetic clutter, the more in alignment we are, the more flow we have, the more we're able to honor what our needs are. Mm-hmm. And so I think how to feel is, or, you know, what the goal might be, what that might look like is knowing how to check in with ourselves. Oh, what do you need right now? Do you need a pause? Are you feeling okay? Mm-hmm. You're doing that thing. It's hard, but you know, it's growth inducing. So you're choosing that, and to name those things and to be able to be clear when you're making some of the choices, and also to be clear, like when you're off track with that, because being off track happens to all of us. I'm sure it happens to you. It certainly 100%. Happens to me, you know? Yes. And so recognizing that as well is like, so if we can use how we feel as a barometer to say, oh, I'm finding myself being really overwhelmed over the last few days. What am I doing? I thought I was honoring my pace better. Yeah. Let me check in with myself about what I'm doing just over these past few days.
So important. And you use the word alignment. It's a word I use all the time. Let's talk about alignment for just a moment, because it is the key to know a lot of times what we are feeling and or not feeling, right? Either way. Mm-hmm. And also, I believe it has a huge impact on that energetic clutter.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. I think when we're in alignment, there's a certain kind of flow that can happen because we're not spending time. Let me speak to it from being out of alignment. So being out of alignment could be something like I'm going about my business and then there's this thing that I feel like I have to do. And I've got this very big should connected to it. And it's connected to, you know, my limiting belief. And then I'm spending a lot of mental energy focused on resentment, feeling frustrated, feeling sorry for myself that I need to be doing this thing, that all of that. And then there's no flow there. Then we're in this place of, and we're not appreciating sort of this choice that we've made because we're feeling like it was this have to thing. And not to say that there aren't things that we're showing up for that we feel like we need to do that. I mean, that does exist in our lives when, you know, we have families or responsibilities. There are certain things that we do need to show up for, but to be able to choose those things and to know when we're choosing those things versus feeling like, oh, poor me, I don't want to have to do that thing. And so being in alignment looks more like checking in and grounding myself because I'm having an energy dip. And I know that that's what my body needs right now. Energetically, I just need to catch my breath. Coming back to, I was sharing the story about me reconnecting to my creative part, having this creative piece in there so that that's something that connects to my soul, a sense of meaning, and that's a bit of a spark for me. So energetically, there's this thing that happens when we're in alignment where there is more movement, more flow, and I think there's more synergy too. So it's like whatever, whoever we're connecting to, if it's in alignment, like right now, even you and I are having this conversation, but I think there's some synergy here because, because it's like, it's connecting to meaning that we both experience and it's impacting us both energetically. And so the more in alignment we are, the more we can have an experience like that. And so our energy gets maximized. There's flow, there's pacing, there's progress isn't the right word, although there's that. So I think just energetically, there's just more if you can allow it.
I love that you went from what does it feel like to be out of alignment, then to bringing it into what it feels like when you are. And it goes really back to gauging your energy, you guys. You know, that's one of the biggest practices I have in my own personal life. You know, maybe my son plays baseball. So if we're at a baseball game really late and I know the next morning is really hectic, I may get up and say, what do I have energy for right now? What can I allow space for today? Maybe I don't have an hour to sit and meditate. Maybe I have 10 minutes. I have to allow that. What do I have space for? Big way to keep ourselves in that alignment space.
I love that. And I also am thinking, because I recently had a group where the focus was avoidance. And I think to know which is so important and can get so confusing because I think people were calling something avoidance that I think was actually what you're just describing, not honoring their energy levels. And both can be true and part of the process and learning when it's one versus one of the other. And that's some of these subtleties that the more you can get used to checking in with yourself, the more you know how to assess what you even need and then give it to yourself.
Yeah. And that goes to the conversation, and we don't have a ton of time to dive into it. So maybe we'll do it another time. Is the idea of procrastinating. People will talk about that all the time. And I'm like, okay, you don't, it's not that you're trying to avoid the situation. It's that you don't have the energy mentally, emotionally, physically, maybe spiritually, even financially to put your intention and alignment into that space.
Yes. I love that because if you think about when we are in alignment and what happens to our energy and our ability, like all of a sudden it seems like we have time for things that we don't feel like we have time for at other times. So I think, getting clear about some of that and actually using that as a way in, because I think, let's say you don't realize that you're disconnected from this goal that you have for whatever reason, it could be energetic, it could be that it's not the right fit, whatever it is. And you're noticing, I keep saying I want to do this thing, but I keep procrastinating. That's a good way to say, oh, let me get a better understanding of that. And that's where, when I was suggesting doing tracking can be really helpful, starting to track where is procrastination showing up and see whether or not you can learn a pattern and then shift a little bit because there's something in there that your behavior is showing you.
Absolutely. And it goes to the clutter thing too, where we start saying, is this my goal? Was this my intention?
Right?
Does this belong to me? Because if it doesn't, that's why I'm procrastinating, is I actually don't want to do this thing.
That's right. That's exactly right. I think a lot of times it's just not the right fit. There's a should connected to it. And to find what's going to honor us most of all can be scary sometimes. Yeah. We might feel like, oh, we've got this path all figured out. And how do we switch gears?
And then that word that I just, I wish it didn't exist. You're selfish, right? You are so selfish.
Yeah.
Or I'm honoring my energy and my needs. Which one is it?
Right. Yeah, I agree. Selfish has such a bad rap. Mm-hmm. And I think that those kinds of ideas get in the way for us when we start to think selfish. And even I think for women, especially for mothers, especially selfless was like this idea of the biggest compliment that somebody could get. And I feel like that's terrible to think that's amazing to be selfless. And I get it. Like there is something about really, you know, valuing your family and taking good care of them. But I don't think selfless is a goal that we should be striving towards.
Right.
Yeah.
I will often ask the ladies that come in, they talk about that, you know, being selfless and, you know, this is what I need and should be doing. I will often say, okay, let me ask you, are you spending your life managing your life or are you living your life?
Yeah.
That will it'll absolutely put that clutter right in place if we spend our whole lives disconnected, out of alignment, and building our energy clutter instead of really being in our lives.
That's right. Yeah. Yeah. And what does that even feel like?
Right.
You know, how do you even make that distinction and helping people? And I think there is this whole getting grounded, being embodied, being present experience when you are connected and aligned that happens. It doesn't happen when you're in the clutter and not paying attention to what's inside.
Yeah. Do you have another tool or tip that we can guide ourselves out of that clutter? You're just talking about getting into alignment and really checking in. Is there something else that you suggest as well?
I just really suggest quiet and giving yourself space. I think to under plan your time, because I think we have a tendency to so overdo it. And it's scary because I think sometimes under planning, you're like, well, I'm not going to get all the things done that I need to get done. But to trust that getting quiet and connecting to yourself, besides the checking in, but I mean, just like pockets throughout the day that you're really giving yourself is so important.
Yeah. I often personally, but I also teach in those pockets of time where we are under planning and we're just sitting, we're getting quiet. Don't chase the rabbit down the hole of thought. Try to allow it to go, but put your hand over your heart. Do some really good deep breathing through your nose. And, you know, if you feel the need, do it out your mouth as well. But slow the nervous system down, so slow the brain down, get into that space where I'm living through this moment of witnessing what's going on within me and not everything that's outside of me.
Yeah. Yeah. I think that's so important. I recently did a certificate program, neurosomatic intelligence, just because I realized what an important part connecting to our bodies is, the nervous system, clearing our nervous system, all of that is so important. And they're just little subtle movements. And it doesn't actually even have to be the structured movements of what I learned in this course, but even things like what you're describing about the breath. I am part of a hiking group. So it gets me out there in nature, connecting in community, being with other people. So things like that, starting to figure out what are some of the things to kind of include in your life on a regular basis that give you this experience of connecting to yourself again and again. What does that look like? And starting to put that together for yourself.
And not forcing it. Is it, you're one that doesn't want to sit there. If that feels too awkward, now give it time, right? The first time you do something, it's going to be uncomfortable no matter what it is. But if you hate it, then that's not the right thing.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
If your love is to go explore a museum, do that.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
That's okay. It doesn't have to be these little cookie cutter experiences. That's not what we want you to do.
That's right. That's right. And I think starting to identify and check it out, you know, what are you going to try? And maybe even have on your intentions for each week, what's one thing I'm going to do to just learn? Does this feel connecting to me? Yeah. Do I enjoy this? Is there a spark here? Mm-hmm. And to start putting that in place. And also, again, a little bit can go a long way. Sometimes just sitting quietly for 30 seconds is a start, and to let that be big.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. That's exactly what I was going to say. That's the place where you celebrate. That's the place where you reach out to that partner and say, I just did this, and not, I only did 30 seconds, or I only did 4 minutes. I did 4 minutes and it was fantastic. Let's take that only away.
That's right. That's right. And also to catch yourself when you dismiss things and say it's too small. It's not going to be anything. It's not good enough. Yeah. Because I think people keep themselves very stuck that way by saying, all right, it's got to be bigger than this, but bigger feels too hard. So I'm not going to do it. I'll do it when I can do this big, hard thing. Mm-hmm. And then that doesn't happen. So.
Yeah. It's actually a practice of mine to, after each task that I'm doing, so whether it's in session or it's group or I'm doing a meditation or I'm teaching a class or this podcast, whatever, I will often tell myself that action or and name it helped me create something new today.
I love that.
That is so, because then I know what my victories and my wins were for the day.
Yeah.
And that's where my mindset is, right? Yeah. Like I'm going to bed thinking, wow, today was a really kick-ass day. It was great.
Yeah. And
you need that. It's okay to celebrate things. It's not egotistical. It's filling.
Right. I love that. And I love the naming of it, to very deliberately put words to it so that it kind of helps you then let it in, recognize it, see it, be a part of this process.
Right. Exactly.
Yeah.
Tell me, is there something that, and I ask this question often, and it's always interesting to me because either they're very much all in alignment or there's some new tidbit that comes out and everybody goes, ah, that was worth every single minute that we were together. Is there something that you wished women knew or that they did to help them get into a place where we're not living in the clutter, but instead engaging in the alignment?
Yeah, I think it's a lot of what we've been talking about, that you're not alone and that you're not selfish to make that a priority. And that in fact, if you can make yourself and your connection to yourself a priority and understand how important that is, it's going to impact your relationships. It's going to impact your work life. It's going to impact what you do for fun. Right. That piece is so connected to the quality of your life and to really trust that and give that to yourself, because I think people back burner it. And I think it would be wonderful for people to really trust that you can go there and give this to yourself. And it's going to be huge.
I agree. And it doesn't have to happen in one day. Like stop that instant gratification. This is a slow burn to the end of the marathon, right? It's not a run at the finish line as fast as you can. That's not what we're trying to do.
Yeah.
So how can people connect with you?
The easiest way to find me is on my website, and my name can be a bit tricky, so I've made it easy. clearenergeticclutter.com.
I love that. Okay. So go there. You said you have a 7-minute masterclass.
Yep. I have a 7-minute masterclass. I have a little 10-minute documentary that I made of how group therapy changed my life. And I made it, I think it was a real labor of love. And I made that, I think, because I wanted people to understand they weren't alone. People can get afraid of going into an environment like that. But if they could see that, how life-changing that can be. So anyway, I made that documentary, and there are some other ways to connect. I do a free discovery session if anybody's interested in exploring group with me. So
Beautiful. It's always important to get into a space that we know we're supported, that we can show up in a very different way than perhaps we've spent all of our lives doing. And there's always tools and there's always something more for us.
Yes.
So I end the podcast the same way. And that is asking you, what are your three gratitudes? What are you personally grateful for that perhaps changed your life, or perhaps what you've learned in this experience that you've had and what you teach? What are your three gratitudes?
I think the three that come to mind are my connection. Can I lump a few together?
Sure.
My connection to my husband and my daughters. So that was what brought me here, right? Like wanting that, I longed to be married and have children, and I was able to figure out how to heal parts of myself so I could connect to that in my life. So that's amazing. I'm grateful for that. Really being able to connect to myself, it feels really like a very important anchor to me to keep coming back to myself again and again, see where I'm at. So that, and really to do work that I love and that it's constantly evolving. We'll see what the creative piece might be. I feel like there's this other thing looming and I'm excited about that, but to be able to really have that also in my life.
Yeah. Beautiful. Mm-hmm. We all need that. We all need something that lights us up from the inside out and creates movement and beauty in our lives. So that's very exciting. Beautiful three. Yes. Thank you for your time, engaging conversation. For everyone who may be feeling stuck, you don't have to be. It's time to just clear the clutter.
Yeah. Thank you so much for having me as a guest. And I really have enjoyed meeting you and connecting with you.
Thank you.
What a fantastic conversation. And the tools that Tanya provided to us are really things that you can start right now outside of therapy or group therapy to elevate your life and to release a lot of that energetic clutter. If you want to know more about this process, group therapy, or any of the tools that were provided, head to Instagram and follow Tanya at Tanya the Therapist. Or you can visit her link in her bio to unlock that 7-minute masterclass and all of her offerings. Thank you so much for listening to the Get Your Life Together Girl podcast. If you've enjoyed these tips for bettering your life, please follow me on social media at Get Your Life Together Girl on Instagram, Facebook, TikTok, and Clapper. You can also visit the show notes, my blog, or any of the merch stores on getyourlifetogethergirl.com. Please feel free to share this episode with a friend or a family member as it helps spread our message to those who need it. While you're on the website, take a look at the Get Your Life Together Girl Women's Circle, where there's over 100 downloadable tools and practices available to you right now. And we meet each month for a group therapy session, and it's only $9 a month. And it's available to everyone across the world. I can't thank you enough for being a valuable part of this community. Until next time, be kind to yourself and others.